Here in the center of False Bay, at the southernmost tip of Africa, is Seal Island. The island is a winter haven to perhaps the densest population of great white sharks and Cape fur seals on Earth. A place where the seal population is over 60,000 and under constant siege from a dozen or so great whites that patrol these waters. It is a perilous journey for the seals that must leave the island and run a gauntlet merely to feed, never quite knowing where or when the next shark will strike. Each attack, as witnessed by the team, is plotted on a map of the island and surrounding sea, clearly illustrating the ring of death. Strong is convinced the sharks prefer to hunt in this ring, where the chances of encountering seals are high as they come and go from the island.
When the sharks are really hunting and when they really have an edge on the seals is when they're swimming deeper, looking up, and then they launch a very secretive attack on that prey, and it just comes out of nowhere, and it's either sudden death or a very near miss. Sudden death is exactly that. It's a very hard hit, brutal to watch, and usually a lot of splashing, sometimes even a fountain of blood.
For this seal, death comes slowly. The shark has numbed it from the pain of a brutal hit, and mercifully the shark will soon return to claim its prize.
It was just a normal day. I was between 15 and 20 foot of water. It was cold, murky, and I was getting towards the end of my breath, and I was getting ready to come up. But I felt a bit of a smack on my side, just like someone just gone and flicked you. And I looked up, and there was just not one fish around me. Realised that I had been bitten.
Vaughn's back and right arm are bitten clear to the bone by a 15-foot great white, a species that's active in cold water because they're warm-bodied. It enables them to move quickly for surprise attacks. They're so fast, the shocking suddenness of the hit is why Vaughn feels no pain and doesn't even know what happened.
The next thing I remember was breaking the surface. Just about starving for air. Oh, I needed more air. I yelled out to the boat boy, and I knew I had to get out of the water.
Vaughn tries to look for the shark.
I put my head back in the water to see if I could see it. And there was just, I couldn't see nothing. There was just a ring of blood around me. I yelled again, and put my head in the water. And well, this time I was starting to get a bit freaked out. I was in the water, and I was sitting there too long.
But getting him on board is a tough task.
I lunged for the boat, but both my wrists collapsed, but nothing responded. And my power hook dropped out of my hand, and you don't drop the tool of your trade, so I was trying to catch it, and nothing would work, mate. From there, the boat boy tried to lift me up, but he couldn't lift me. Oh, it's probably a dead weight.
Eddie, help me, we got a shark attack.
Vaughn's diving partner, Eddie Rarity, races over to help, knowing that he could also be attacked. Eddie bravely stays in the water to help his friend to safety.
I was going out for a typical day's diving down to one of my favorite areas, which is called Cape Howe.
Below, visibility is poor. A typical day for abalone fishing.
I was about to bump off a good-sized abalone and a huge force hit me. Everything went black.
Half of Eric's body is inside the jaws of a massive great white.
I felt like a vice-like pressure upon my chest and back. I didn't realise I was actually in a shark until it shook me sideways. I realised I was actually getting eaten alive. I've never felt fear like that in my entire life. I really thought my time was up.
Great whites ambush their prey at speeds of up to 20 miles per hour and tend to strike from behind and below. Eric's head-on encounter with the shark is unusual, and it gives him a fighting chance.
I put my hand up on the side of the shark's face and felt an object like half a tennis ball covered in slimy membrane. I'd found the eye.
He squeezes it, and the shark briefly opens its jaw. Eric starts to back out.
But the bottom jaw closed again, this time over my face mask. I felt my nose break and some teeth started to penetrate in the back of my head.
Bleeding and running out of breath, he squeezes the eye again and he's free. He immediately finds his air regulator and takes a huge breath. Then he begins a slow, terrifying ascent to the surface.
The shark just cruised around me in slow circles, staring at me. And although I didn't have my face mask, I could see quite clearly because the shark was so close to me that it was a great white. The fear of that was almost too much to bear.
Keeping cool under incredible pressure, Eric realizes that a fast, panicky ascent will signal the shark that he's in trouble and invite another attack. Instead, he moves slowly to the surface, holding out his bag of abalone as a distraction should the shark move in for a second try.
Just that anticipation probably was my greatest fear, actually thinking that I was going to get eaten again. If that shark wanted me, it had me.